Hello everyone. In this lecture, we will be discussing the implementation of InfoGAN using TensorFlow. So, as you can see on this slide, we have already derived this expression for InfoGAN in our earlier lecture. So, what it states is that the cost function of the InfoGAN, which is represented as V subscript InfoGAN DGQ, is actually equal to V D comma G minus lambda times Li G comma Q. Here lambda is the regularization parameter and D is the discriminator, G is the generator and Q is the auxiliary network that we have introduced. So what we are doing is we are actually minimizing over the generator and the auxiliary network Q and maximizing over the discriminator D. And we have also derived this expression for Li, which is the lower bound that we have derived in our earlier lecture, and that is equal to this expression, where this is the entropy of the code C and this is the auxiliary network that we have introduced, and this is the expectation on the log of auxiliary network Q. Also, this VD comma G is the cost function corresponding to generative adversarial network that also we have discussed in greater detail in our earlier lectures. So this is just a small recap of what we have done in our earlier lecture. So let's start implementing this in Google Colab. But before doing that, I will just show you this InfoGAN architecture again, where we have this as the data, that is the original data, for example, of that of MNIST fashion data set or MNIST digit data set. So what we are doing is we are feeding this data into this discriminator, and this is the generator that we have over here, which takes input as the combination of Z and C, which is the codes that are hidden into this vector that we are feeding into the generator, and this is the auxiliary network that we have created, which, and the job of this auxiliary network is or to estimate the generated code which is hidden in this vector which is given over here. So what we are doing here is we are taking a very simple case of neural network, which is a single layer neural network, where we have the discriminator defined with a single layer neurons, and we have at the output only one unit. And the reason for that is, since we have to make a binary decision for the discriminator to show that whether it is 0 for the fake samples and 1 for the real samples. So for that case, we need only one unit. That's why we are taking it as 1 over here. And similarly, for the generator also, we are taking a single layer neural network. But at the output of, but the second layer of this neural network, which is the output, will have the dimensions of the image. We will discuss this when we will be going in the details of the coding. But please note here, the discriminator will have only single layer at the output node, whereas in the generator, it will have the same dimension as that of the image, because at the output of this generator is the generated image. In this lecture, we have taken this neural network as a very simplified version. So you can take either CNN over here. So that will be a more advanced version of these neural networks. So for our choice, I have taken this as a very simple neural network. And one more thing what you can do is you can increase the number of layers between the two layers, which is this layer and this layer. So it depends on your choice. For my case, I have taken only a very simplified version just to show how we can implement InfoGAN in TensorFlow. So let's see the implementation. This is the basic importing of the library so that our TensorFlow will run perfectly. These are the training parameters that we have taken. A batch size of 32, epoch I have taken as 100,000. These are the dimensions of the Z and the C code. And what is this? This is basically the code that we are feeding into the generator. So the dimension of the Z we have taken as 16 and the dimension of the code we have taken as 10. So this is what this and this means. And the batch size taken as 32. Image dimension is taken as 784, and that is basically flattening of the 28 cross 28 images which are present in MNIST dataset. The discriminator node, which is represented over here as given 128, means that what we are doing is these nodes are taken as 128. In the next, the generator nodes are taken as 256, means we are taking these number of nodes over here as 256. The auxiliary network defined by q_h1 is taken as 128. That means in the auxiliary network also we have taken 128 number of nodes in a single layer neural network, and the output of this will have the same dimension as that of the code C, because we are estimating C hat from this neural network. So the output should be of same dimension as that of C, and since we have taken C as 10, so these nodes will be also of 10 nodes. Here what we are defining are the dictionaries corresponding to the weights of the discriminator, and they are defined as in this way. These are the weight and bias dictionaries defined for the generator, and these are the weights and bias dictionaries defined for auxiliary networks. So what this is actually showing you is the weights of the generator, which are basically connected between these two layers and between these two layers. So we have these weights corresponding to this interconnection defined by gen_h, and these weights defined over here defined by gen_final, and the bias corresponding to this generator dictionaries are defined for this layer and for this layer, and the names of that are gen_bias. Similarly, for the discriminator also we have weights that are connected between these layers and the weights that are connected between this input in between this layer and the output node. So we are defining for these the weights of the discriminator and the bias for this node and this node. In the same way we have for auxiliary network Q, and they are actually represented over here. One thing to note here is that in case of the discriminator, the output node has output layer has only one node. In case of generator, the output has 784 nodes, and the reason for that is since we are generating an image from the generator output, so that's why its dimension is 784. And in the case of auxiliary network, the output nodes are equal to the dimension of the C as we have just discussed, so it will be C_dim. That is what we have written over here. So the next is to define the placeholders, and the placeholders are the entry points for the computational graph. So we have these three placeholders defined. As you can see on this slide also, we have data that is coming into this graph from three sides. One is the data coming from here, it is going through the discriminator, and the other is the data that is coming from this side. That is, we have C and Z, which are acting as a placeholder which feeds the data into this generator. So we have these three values, that is X, C and Z, acting as a placeholder. So that's why we have defined these placeholders over here. These are the distributions for Z that we have assumed. As we have already told that this vector that is composed of C and Z has some distribution. So Z follows the random distribution which is given over here, and C follows the multinomial distribution which is given over here. You can refer to the Python library for this function, which is np_random.multinomial. Then we will see that the first entry point is how many times you are running this distribution, 1 run, 2 run or 10 runs. So we have taken it as 1 over here, and this is basically defining the probability of the code. Here we have 10 samples in the code, and each one have a probability of 1/10. So this is what is defined over here. So this is defining the distribution of C. So next we are creating a computational graph. And what is this computational graph? This computational graph is how we will actually implement the neural network that we have defined inside the generator, inside the discriminator, and inside the auxiliary neural network. So as I told you that we have taken a generator in a very simplified way, in which we have inputs to this generator having 128 nodes, and the output is a single node output. So what we are doing over here is we are actually connecting the inputs X, not here, over here. So what we are doing is we are actually connecting the input X to this network, which is the generator network. And the way we are doing that is through this code, and this is not generator, it is discriminator. And in case of generator, we are feeding the input using the codes which is a combination of C and Z. So that's why over here we are taking two nodes which are Z and C, which are taken as the feeding vector to the generator input, and it produces the output which is a dimension of 784, which is the size of image. So that's why it is taking two codes Z and C and producing the output gen underscore output, which is of dimension 784. And this is the auxiliary neural network that we have defined, which takes the output of this generated network. This is the generator, and so output of this generated network is fed into the auxiliary network Q, and it produces the estimated code C hat, which is represented as Q underscore prob underscore output. So you can see how we have defined all these neural networks using these codes which are discussed over here. So now what we will do is we will build the InfoGAN network. So how we will do that? We will do that by calling the generator function that we have defined in our this part. So we will call this generator function. So what it will do is it will call this generator function, which takes Z and C as the vectors, and it produces an image which is samples underscore generated. So this is basically G of Z comma C in the derivations that we have already done. What is the next thing? The next thing is the discriminator is basically taking two inputs. One is coming from the real data, another is coming from the generated data. So the thing that is coming from the real data is represented as real underscore output underscore disk, and this is basically G of X. This is basically G of X. This is G of Z comma C. And how about the fake data? This is D of X, not G of X. So this is basically D of G of Z comma C. So these lines of codes are basically implementing these equations which we have already used for our derivations. And what is this doing? Estimated underscore C. So what it is doing is it is calling the auxiliary network, which takes, so once you call auxiliary underscore NN, means you are calling this Q network, and it takes input this G of Z comma C, which is actually coming from here. So it's taking this as the input and producing the output C hat, which is estimated underscore C. So this is actually C hat. So next, what we are doing is we are defining the losses corresponding to this generator, this discriminator, and this auxiliary network. So for the discriminator and the generator part, it is similar to the generative adversarial network that we have already discussed in our earlier lectures. So you can see there how we have written this for generative adversarial networks. So it's not different from there. For the auxiliary network, there is a slight difference, and the difference is that we are using this as our loss function. And what is this saying? It is saying that we are taking tf.log of estimated underscore C. What is this estimated underscore C? This estimated underscore C is C hat. And if you see the theory behind here, so when we will be minimizing over Q, what that means is we will be taking only that variables which involves Q. So in this and this equation, the only variable that involves Q is this expression. So what this expression says is, it is saying that it is sampling C from probability of C, and then it is sampling X from G of Z comma C. And once these two are sampled, they are fed into this network, which generates the conditional probability distribution Q of C given X, which we have implemented using auxiliary neural network. So as you can see that we have over here estimated underscore C. So we are taking log of this estimated underscore C. So what that is doing is it is basically doing log of Q of C given X, and the C is basically sampled from P of C, which is actually implemented using this, and X is basically coming from G of Z comma C, which is basically coming from estimated underscore C. And the reason for that is that estimated underscore C is taking samples underscore generated as the input, and that generated input is G of Z comma C. So that's why this equation is implementing this part. and this is taken as constant, so we are not involving this into our cost function of the Q. Please note that C is the placeholder which is taking input from the sample distribution, that's why it is indirectly implementing this. That is, C is sampled from probability distribution of C over here. So the next step is to define the optimizer so that we can train the neural network. So for generator, discriminator and auxiliary network, we are defining the ADAM optimizer with the learning rate that we have already defined in our earlier part of the code. And what we are doing is, we are minimizing the generator loss, discriminator loss and the auxiliary loss, Q underscore loss, which we have defined over here and discussed in details. The thing that we have to note is which parameters are need to be optimized. So in case of generator, we have to optimize the generator parameters. That's why in the where underscore list, we have generator parameters getting optimized. In the case of discriminator, we have discriminator parameters to be optimized. So these parameters are defined over here, which are nothing but the weights and bias of these networks. However, in case of auxiliary network, it involves optimization of the auxiliary network Q itself along with the generator network. So we have to optimize the weights and bias for these two together. And in that case, the discriminator network will have constant parameters and there will be no updates during this situation where we are optimizing the auxiliary parameters, auxiliary network parameters. This is initialization of the session. And now we are running the session and we are taking xpatch, znoise and cnoise from the distributions and calculating the discriminator, generator and the auxiliary network loss for each epoch and then printing the epochs. So once we run this part of the code, the network will get optimized and trained, and once it is trained, then we can use the generator network to generate new images. So this part of the code is used for generating new images, and there are two ways we are providing the code. C underscore noise code, which is the code that we are feeding to the generator. One way is this one and another way is this one. So we will see what kind of results we will obtain if we change C underscore noise from here to here. So there are two ways of doing that, and what we are producing at the output is basically the generated image, which is G, which takes test underscore output as the input. Once we run test underscore output as one of test underscore output, it calls this function, which is generator z underscore c, which takes two inputs z and c, which we are feeding over here. So the generated images which are stored in test underscore output will be executed, and we will plot it in the canvas fashion over here. So this is basically the detail of the TensorFlow code that we have discussed here. So let's move to Google Colab and see what results we will obtain. So here we present the TensorFlow code for InfoGAN implemented in Google Colab. So as discussed, these are normal importing of the libraries. This is basically importing the data corresponding to MNIST dataset. So let's execute this. So this is executing. So it's executed. So this is basically reading the dataset and storing it in content underscore data. And we are doing one hot encoding onto the labels and we are calling it as true. So we are reading that, we are putting it in MNIST variable. So let's run this. So once you run this, the data is downloaded and it is stored in the content folder, stored in the data folders, which is provided over here. That is the content underscore data. So if you want to see here, and you can see that the data is stored over here. These are the parameters that we are setting up for the codes for the neural network. This is executed. This is actually the Xavier initialization that we are normally doing it. And the reason for that is, if you initialize with Xavier initialization, then the execution will be fast and it will be converging faster. So let's define this Xavier initialization first. And as you can see that all the weights and the biases are initialized with this Xavier underscore initialization. So let's execute this. So this defines the weights and bias dictionaries for the discriminator, generator and auxiliary network. This we have already discussed in details. This is defining the placeholders for the computational graph, which are x, z and c. These are the distributions that the z and c will follow. So let's execute this. This creates the computational graph that we have already discussed. That is, the generator will take two inputs, that is Z and C. And please note that here the input will be concatenated. As you know, we have already shown that the generator will have a single vector comprising of Z and C. So we are concatenating these two vectors, which is very important. So once we concatenate these two vectors, it will create a single vector which is of input name. So this input will be then fed into the generator network, which is defined over here, which has one hidden layer and a output layer defined as gen underscore output. And the dimension of this gen underscore output is the dimension of the image itself. So it will be of value 784 cross 1. Similarly, for the discriminator, it will take input as x. And the reason it is taking only one input is either you feed a real data distribution over here or the generated data from generator Z, C. That's why it is taking only one input. For the auxiliary neural network also, it is taking only one input. So now we are building up the InfoGAN network, and that is done over here as we have discussed this in greater details. So let's execute this first. So once this is executed, we will build the InfoGAN network using these calling of functions. So once we execute this, these called functions will actually interconnect with each other and form a InfoGAN network. These are the loss functions that we have discussed, corresponding to discriminator loss. This is for generator loss. This is for auxiliary network loss. So let's execute this also. And these are the parameter list of the discriminator that has to be updated, for the generator that has to be updated, and for auxiliary network that has to be updated. And we are calling them as disk underscore param, gen underscore param, and q underscore param. And these parameter list will be used in this optimizer calling function, where we are taking Adam optimizer for all these three networks, that are the generator, discriminator, and auxiliary network. And we are minimizing the corresponding losses over here. And these are the list of the parameters that are to be updated. So let's run this. So now once the optimizers are defined, let's initialize the variables, run the session, and run the session for, and within the session we will be running for 100,000 epochs, and within this loop we will be calculating the loss function for the discriminator, generator, and auxiliary networks and printing the same. And once this block of code is executed, our neural network will get trained. So let's run this. And now you can see that for each iteration we are printing the discriminator loss, generator loss, and auxiliary loss, and this will run till 100,000 iterations. So let's wait for that to finish. So now you can see that our code is executed and we have completed all the 100,000 iterations, and these are the discriminator, generator, and auxiliary losses that we have reported. So once this block of code is executed, our neural network is trained. So now the time has come to generate new images from the generator network. For that case, what we are taking is, since you know that the generator requires two inputs Z and C, so we will artificially create, we will sample the Z from the Z distribution that we have defined over here, and this Z underscore distribution we have already defined. So we are sampling Z from this distribution, and we are taking batch size, that is 32 samples of dimension Z underscore dim, which is 16. So this actually samples Z underscore noise from this distribution. And next what we will do is, we will sample the code from the C underscore distribution. So this is actually implementing PC, that is P bracket C, and we are sampling C from P bracket C. This is another way of doing it. So I'll just hide it for a time being, and I will show you what this is doing. But before that, let's see how we are generating the images by taking Z underscore noise and C underscore noise vectors, which are sampled from Z underscore distribution and C underscore distribution. So we will do sess.run on the test underscore output, which is in turn basically calling the generator, which in turn requires Z and C, which we are giving over here. And now what we are doing is, we are generating the images using this block of code. So let's run this. So now you can see that the InfoGAN has generated new images, that these are the new style images which are not there in MNIST dataset. So this finishes the implementation of InfoGAN neural network. So there is one more point that I wanted to discuss over here is, that if we let us say disable this and then use this as the code, so what it will do is it will do something that you can see over here, and the thing is we are defining id equal to 0. We can put it as 0 or 1 or 2 or 5 or 7 or anything between 0 to 9. So once we put this id as equal to 9, so it will create C underscore noise with labeling of 1 corresponding to this id, which is 9. So this means if you put 9 over here, then this 1 will be kept in the 9th position, and if you put it as 6, then this 1 will be kept in the 6th position. So what we want to see over here is what impact this C underscore noise will have on to the generated images if we keep on changing this id. So if we put id as 6 and let's run this, then you can see that it generates images over here which encodes some special characteristics which are hidden. But what we can see from here is that the images are getting slanted as we progress from left to right. So maybe this id equal to 6 encodes the slantness of the image profiles. Let's put it as 8 and execute this again. So now you can see that the generated images are now different. It will try to encode some hidden characteristics of this generated image. It may be the increase of thickness from left to right or rotation of the images from left to right. So right now it's very hard to distinguish over here the difference between these images, but the point you can understand is that with the changing of this ID, that is you are changing this with different values, you are actually generating images having some profile characteristics from either left to right or from top to bottom. So there will be some change in the profile of the images. So these are basically the labels. So you are changing ID means you are changing the labels of the images. So these labels are trying to capture basically the properties of this MNIST dataset. So whether it will be change of the thickness or change of strokes or rotation, that depends. And one more thing that I have to discuss over here is that the quality of the generated images are not that good, and the reason for that is we are taking only single layer neural network. In order to increase the quality of that, you can try with multiple layer neural networks or using convolutional neural networks. Once you do that, the quality of the images will become more better. So this completes the discussion of InfoGAN, which included all the theory that we have discussed in our earlier lecture along with the Google Colab code implemented in TensorFlow. Thanks for watching my lecture. See you next time.